Before the internet, there was the bulletin board system, or BBS for short. At its core, a BBS essentially is just computer software that runs and allows users to connect to it via terminal comm software. Once logged in, the user can perform a host of different things, which ranges from downloading and uploading files, playing games, message boards, chat services, and even some internet functionality like FTP and IRC. In order to connect to a BBS, you would need to use a dial-up modem. These modems utilize the serial port on most computers via RS-232, which was a standard for serial communication for transmission and retrieval of data. Almost every home computer has a serial port, and combined with a modem and some terminal software, could provide a standard way for any machine to get online. BBSs were truly the precursor to the internet, and in 1994, it was estimated that there were 60,000 BBSs in the US alone. However, by 1995, when Windows 95 and web browsers came along, the popularity of BBSs started to decline, and the internet age was born. Now, in today's world, bulletin boards are still around. There's still quite a lot of them out there worldwide, and there's actually a website you can go to pull up a comprehensive list of different bulletin boards around the world. Now, the more popular bulletin board services are still being actively used on a daily basis, with many, many users still connecting to them. Now, a gentleman by the name of Paul Reichards has developed what's called the WiFi 232, which is a haze-compatible modem emulator, which allows you to plug in this device into the serial port of any retro or modern computer, and it will emulate a haze modem. Now, what's cool about this is you don't actually need to plug in a null modem cable or an external modem to make this work. You just need to plug in the Wi-Fi 232 modem device and configure it. We're going to show you how to do that. So here's the Wi-Fi 232 modem. It costs $30 in kit form and $48 fully assembled. I went for the fully assembled model. It simply plugs into any standard serial port with a DB25 connector. Some computers will have the smaller 9-pin port or a mini DIN, like on the Apple 2GS for example, so you will need to provide an adapter. Now for this video, I'm going to use my Atari ST. Just plug the Wi-Fi 232 into the serial port, apply power, and this blue light should illuminate. Next, we need to power up the Atari ST and use an appropriate terminal emulator software. The Atari ST has quite a few of them, but the one that I ended up with is called TAS. Now, if you use an Atari ST, make sure that you are in medium res or high res screen modes, as the low res mode is only 40 columns wide and many terminal programs won't accept this configuration. Okay, the first thing you need to do is set up your terminal software and set it to 1200 baud. Then type the command ATI. That should give you some information about the device and will indicate that it's interfacing with the serial port. Now, in order to get the Wi-Fi modem online, you need to provide the wireless ID and password of your network. Once that's done, you should be able to connect the device to your Wi-Fi network. And by typing the command ATC1, we'll connect the Wi-Fi 232 modem to your wireless network, and you should see a connection message as well as an IP address of the device. You can also update the firmware of the device by keying in AT update check. This will determine if a new firmware is available, and the command AT update will download and apply the new firmware to the hardware. It's recommended that you do this to be on the latest firmware at all times. You can also change the baud rate to a faster speed. The max that this stock Atari ST will utilize, however, is 19,200 baud, which is roughly 2.4 kilobytes per second. Now that we are configured, let's check out some BBSs. One of my personal favorites is a2tk.org. To connect to a BBS in the old days of dial-up modems, you would type the command ATDT and then the telephone number. This is a haze command to tell the modem to perform touch dialing. But since this is an internet modem, we just need to provide the IP address or domain name. In this instance, it's bbs.at2k.org. Now, when you connect to a BBS, you will be asked if your terminal may support ANSI graphics or it may detect it for you automatically. At its core, ANSI is a set of escape sequences that provide things like colors and cursor placements. It usually provides a more interactive experience. When you connect to a BBS, you will usually be prompted to log in, register a new user, or sign in as a guest user and take a look around. Most BBSs will show you who else is connected at the same time as you, and you could establish a real-time chat session with users online, or the SysOp, which is the owner of the BBS. I'm going to register as a new user on the BBS and walk you through the steps. Now, most BBSs want some basic demographic information. This was quite common back in the day. Once you've signed up, typically you will be required to send a message to the SysOp and let them know about yourself and your interests. The SysOp has the right to deny your application if he or she so chooses, and many of the more exclusive BBSs back in the 80s and 90s usually needed someone to vouch for you before being accepted into it. Many BBSs have email capability either by utilizing internet mail or a local BBS mail where you could only send email to other users on the same BBS as you. Now, once you've signed into the BBS and let the SysOp know that you are here, they will usually notify you and welcome you to the BBS. ANSI art is a computer art form that's very popular on BBSs. It's very similar to ASCII art, but can utilize 16 foreground and 8 background colors. Many BBSs have some amazing ANSI art if that's your style. I'm a huge fan and can spend hours looking at different works. Internet Relay Chat, or IRC, is available on most BBSs. This is a very powerful feature because before dial-up internet was the norm, it allowed BBS users to get connected outside of their BBS to users around the world. Here's me connected to the Amiga channel on my Atari ST. Most BBSs will have a games menu. There are many games you can play. Multi-user dungeons or MUDs were quite popular. You can even try out text adventure games. This BBS has the entire Infocom text adventure back catalog. You can play each of these games, save your position and return to it later. Roguelikes are another popular BBS game you can play, such as NetHack and Mines of Moria. And when you're done BBSing, simply log off and the Wi-Fi 232 will disconnect you from the IP address that you previously specified. When you disconnect, the words "no carrier" will appear. This is a haze response that indicates that the modem is no longer connected to the remote system, or, to put it another way, that the telephone line carrier signal has been lost. I also wanted to demonstrate how this device will work across different computers. I plugged the Wi-Fi 232 into my Commodore Amiga 500 and loaded up NCOM, which is terminal COM software that runs on Kickstart 1.3 and connected to the same at2k.org BBS from before. As you can see, it runs just the same, although this machine could use with some fast RAM to speed it up. On Paul's website, he has a list of all confirmed systems that the Wi-Fi 232 is working with, and I would expect many more to follow. I ran out of time making this video, but I even tested this device with my Sharp X68000 and MU term, and it works just fine.
I really want to thank Paul Reichards for coming up with a device like this. It's an ingenious piece of hardware, and I've had so much fun playing around with it. And if you have that nostalgia to get back into bulletin boards, check out this device. It's an amazing piece of kit. Now, if you guys have any questions about the Wi-Fi 232 modem or anything else in this video, please leave a comment below. As always, don't forget to like and subscribe, and I'll catch you guys in the next video. Bye for now.